Our next guest is a literary critic, a professor, a historian, and a public intellectual who, in his spare time, is the host of a hit show on PBS. Please welcome Henry Louis Gates Jr.
Thank you. This is my first time on the real, so I am very honored to be here. Especially,
we are happy to have you.
But especially the morning after Ralph Warnock won in Georgia. Thank you, Jesus. You know, this is fabulous.
Thank you, Jesus is right.
God is good.
Dr. Gates, it's such an honor to finally have you here. We're going to get into your show in just a minute. But first, you recently wrote to the head of the National Institution of Health, volunteering to publicly take the COVID-19 vaccine. What inspired you to do that?
Well, Francis Collins, of course, is the head of the NIH, and I had the pleasure of tracing his ancestry last year on Finding Your Roots, and I think of him as a friend. And I read an article on ProPublica, and full disclosure, I'm on the board of directors of ProPublica, the investigative website, and it said that many people of color were reluctant to take the vaccine because of the long history of the relationship between racism and science, and particularly demonic white racist pseudoscientists experimenting on black people. And everyone knows the most famous example is the infamous Tuskegee syphilis experiment. So terrible. As soon as I read it, I fired off an email to Dr. Collins and said, I just read that you're looking for prominent African Americans. You know, I'm not Oprah or Denzel, but, you know, in my world, you know, if I'm prominent enough, I volunteer. I would take the vaccine right now. In fact, if you had it, you could administer it to me right this second. One, because everyone's terrified of COVID. And two, our people, brown people and black people, have been disproportionately affected by COVID. COVID has been colorized. We need the vaccine even more than our white fellow citizens. If, you know, we need it just as much, but judging by the fatalities because of the comorbidity rates that have been inflicted people of color. So if I can be useful to the National Institute of Health, I volunteer.
Dr. Gates, as a teacher and a historian, what do you think were the main lessons of 2020? And where do you think we go from here?
I think the main lesson, that's a fabulous question. The main lesson for me of 2020 is that two things, that class matters big time in the United States. And then secondly, we're still living with the collapse of Reconstruction in the late 19th century, that white supremacy, which rose in reaction to what Congressman Jim Clyburn, when I interviewed him for my series on Reconstruction, said was the first manifestation of black power. And that was the power of the black vote. In the summer of 1867, March 1867, black men in the former Confederacy got the right to vote 3 years before the ratification of the 15th Amendment. And guess what? They registered to vote 80% of all eligible black men in the former Confederacy. Now remember, most of these men are illiterate because it was illegal to teach slaves, our enslaved ancestors, to read and write. Right. 80% registered to vote. And in 1868, in the general election, they voted. Ulysses S. Grant won the presidency overwhelmingly in the Electoral College, but he only won the popular vote by just over 300,000 ballots. 500,000 black men cast their votes for Ulysses S. Grant. Wow. Black men had elected a president of the United States 3 years after the end of the Civil War. And here's the other astonishing fact. South Carolina, Mississippi, and Louisiana were majority black states, and Florida, Georgia, and Alabama were almost majority black states. It was like a mini black republic. And white people in the South, but also in the North, they went, oh, Negroes out of control. We have to roll this back. And so starting in 1890 with Mississippi, each former Confederate state adopted a new state constitution that effectively disenfranchised black men. And you want to know how effective it was? In 1890, there were 170,000 black men registered to vote in Louisiana. By 1904, that number had been reduced precisely to 1,342.
Wow.
That's amazing. And we saw Donald Trump manipulating the tropes of white supremacy in his political campaign, and then even more during his presidency. And we saw the specter of white supremacy. You know, it was like a bad science fiction movie. You know, you think these diabolical, demonic forces are dead, and then everybody's sitting around eating dinner, and you hear something, and up comes out of the floor the devil. And that devil was white supremacy. So when you saw how many people of color, but we saw how many people of color disproportionately died from COVID. And then look at the number of people who are unemployed, record numbers of people who are unemployed, and look at the stock market. The stock market is at a record high. There are two distinct classes in this country, and we need to do something about it. And if we ditch
Mitch. Well, you have certainly done your part. You have definitely done your part in keeping us informed and just keeping us entertained as well with your show, Finding Your Roots with Henry Louis Gates Jr. Okay, this season we actually saw you trace the roots of guests like Gayle King, Issa Rae, and Jordan Peele. So I have to ask, do you have a favorite guest or story from, you know, years past?
Well, it's kind of like your children, right? You are too young to have children, I think. But I have two children and a grandchild. You can't pick. But one of the best stories, because it was the first one we filmed, was of Oprah Winfrey's great-great-grandfather. His name was Constantine Winfrey. And he shows up in the 1870 census, which is the first census in which all Black Americans are listed, because the censuses didn't list enslaved people by name, right? So there's Constantine Winfrey living in Atala County, Mississippi, next door to a white man named Absalom Winfrey. So I went, So I went back and looked at the 1860 census and looked at the slave schedule, which listed all the slaves, not by name, but by color, age, and gender that a slave owner owned. And there was Absalom Winfrey, and he had a slave exactly 10 years younger than Constantine Winfrey was in 1870. And they were living next door to each other. And so then I wanted to check out, so I figured out that's who owned Oprah's great-great-grandfather. So then I wanted to figure out, how did Oprah become Oprah? Well, Constantine Winfrey was illiterate in 1870. In 1876, he walks up to a white man named John Watson and said he wants to buy 80 acres of bottom land, beautiful bottom land with a stream running through it, but he didn't have any money, but he offered to pick up 2,000 pounds of cotton. And if he did it within a certain prescribed time, John Watson would have to give him the land. And we know that the brother succeeded because I showed Oprah the deed turning over that 80 acres from John Watson to Constantine.
Wow.
And then, and guess what? Constantine signed the deed with his own name. And in 1870, he was illiterate. So in 10 years, this brother had learned to read and write. He had owned 80 acres, and 2 years later, he paid $250 and bought 80 more adjacent acres.
Jeez,
so you want to know
why
Oprah is the queen? She is the queen because she descends from this brother, Constantine Winfrey. Isn't that a hell of a story?
Great story. That's a great story. Can we please, let's take a look at a clip of you and Nancy Pelosi in Finding Your Roots with Henry Louis Gates Jr.
Her father made history when he became the first Italian American to be elected the mayor of Baltimore. And her family was like royalty in Baltimore's Little Italy, a fact that shaped Nancy to her core.
As a child, I understood that we had additional responsibilities to our neighbors, to our community, and to the city of Baltimore.
Mm-hmm.
As I always say, I was born into a family that was devoutly Catholic, fiercely patriotic, loving America, proud of our Italian-American heritage, and staunchly Democratic.
Wow.
My goodness.
I want to see
You know
that.
What? So Thank good. You so much, Dr. Gates, for being with us today. Finding Your Roots with Henry Louis Gates Jr. airs Tuesdays at 8. You do not want to miss this wonderful, wonderful show. It airs on PBS.